కృష్ణ చైతన్న ప్రభో నిత్యానంద శ్రీ అద్వైత గదాధార శివాషది గౌరవ
Krishna Productions presents a dramatic narration of the book Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. But first, a few words of introduction about the book, the main characters, the author, and the translator. Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita is the principal work on the life and teachings of Sri Krishna Chaitanya. The three words of the title mean the character of the living force in immortality. Lord Chaitanya appeared in this world on February 18, 1486. He is the pioneer of a great social and religious movement which began in India in the early 1500s. And which has directly and indirectly influenced the subsequent course of religious and philosophical thinking, not only in India, but in the West as well. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is regarded as a figure of great historical significance. However, our conventional method of historical analysis, that of seeing a man as a product of his times, fails here. Sri Chaitanya is a personality who transcends the limited scope of historical settings. At a time when, in the West, man was directing his explorative spirit towards studying the structure of the physical universe and circumnavigating the world in search of new oceans and continents, Sri Krishna Chaitanya in the East was inaugurating and masterminding a revolution directed inward toward a scientific understanding of the highest knowledge of man's spiritual nature. The chief historical sources for the life of Sri Krishna Chaitanya are the Kadachas or diaries kept by Murari Gupta and Swarup Damodar Goswami. Murari Gupta, a physician and close associate of Sri Chaitanya's, recorded extensive notes on the first 24 years of Sri Chaitanya's life, culminating in his initiation into the renounced order or sannyas. The events of the rest of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's 48 years are recorded in the diary of Swarup Damodar Goswami, another of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's intimate associates. Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita is divided into three sections called Leelas, which literally mean pastimes. Adi Leela, the early period, Madhya Leela, the middle period, and Antya Leela, the final period. The notes of Murari Gupta form the basis of the Adi Leela, and Swarup Damodar's diary provides the details for the Madhya and Antya Leelas. The first 12 of the 17 chapters of Adi Leela constitute the preface for the entire work. By referring to Vedic scriptural evidence, this preface establishes Sri Chaitanya as the avatar or incarnation of Krishna, God, for the age of Kali, the current epoch, beginning 5,000 years ago and characterized by materialism, hypocrisy, and dissension. In these descriptions, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is identical with Lord Krishna, descends to liberally grant pure love of God to the fallen souls of this degraded age by propagating Sankirtan, literally, congregational glorification of God, especially by organizing massive public chanting of the Maha Mantra, or Great Chant of Deliverance. The esoteric purpose of Lord Chaitanya's appearance in the world is revealed, his co-avatars and principal devotees are described, and his teachings are summarized. The remaining portion of Adi Lila, chapters 13 to 17, briefly recounts his divine birth and his life until he accepted the renounced order. This includes his childhood miracles, schooling, marriage, and early philosophical confrontations, as well as his organization of a widespread Sankirtan movement and his civil disobedience against the repression of the Mohammedan government. The subject of Madhya Lila, the longest of the three divisions, is a detailed narration of Lord Chaitanya's extensive and eventful travels throughout India as a renounced mendicant, teacher, philosopher, spiritual preceptor, and mystic. During this period of 6 years, Sri Chaitanya transmits his teachings to his principal disciples. He debates and converts many of the most renowned philosophers and theologians of his time, including Shankarites, Buddhists, and Muslims, and incorporates their many thousands of followers and disciples into his own burgeoning numbers. A dramatic account of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's miraculous activities at the giant Jagannath Cart Festival in Orissa is also included in this section. Antya Lila concerns the last 18 years of Sri Chaitanya's manifest presence, spent in semi-seclusion near the famous Jagannath Temple at Jagannath Puri in Orissa. During these final years, Sri Chaitanya drifted deeper and deeper into trances of spiritual ecstasy, unparalleled in all of religious and literary history, Eastern or Western. Sri Chaitanya's perpetual and ever-increasing religious beatitude, graphically described in the eyewitness accounts of Svarup Damodar Goswami, his constant companion during this period, clearly defy the investigative and descriptive abilities of modern psychologists and phenomenologists of religious experience. The author of this great classic, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, born in the year 1507, was a disciple of Raghunath Das Goswami, a confidential follower of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Raghunath Das Goswami endowed him with a full comprehension of the transcendental life of Sri Chaitanya. By this time, several biographical works had already been written on the life of Sri Chaitanya by contemporary and near-contemporary scholars and devotees. These included Sri Chaitanya Charita by Murari Gupta, Chaitanya Mangal by Lochan Das Thakur, and Chaitanya Bhagavat. This latter text, a work by Vrindavan Das Thakur, who was then considered the principal authority on Sri Chaitanya's life, was highly revered. While composing his important work, Vrindavan Das, fearing that it would become too voluminous, avoided elaborately describing many of the events of Sri Chaitanya's life, particularly the later ones. Anxious to hear of these later pastimes, the devotees of Vrindavan requested Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, whom they respected as a great saint, to compose a book to narrate these episodes in detail. Upon this request, and with the permission and blessings of the Madan Mohan deity of Vrindavan, he began compiling Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, which, due to its biographical excellence and thorough exposition of Lord Chaitanya's profound philosophy and teachings, is regarded as the most significant of biographical works on Sri Chaitanya. This English translation is the work of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, a most distinguished teacher of Indian religious and philosophical thought, and the founder and spiritual guide of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. He appeared in this world on September 1st, 1896, in Calcutta, India, and departed from it on November 14th, 1977, in Vrindavan, India. His divine grace is a disciplic descendant of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and is the first scholar to execute systematic English translations of the major works of Sri Chaitanya's followers. His consummate Bengali and Sanskrit scholarship and intimate familiarity with the precepts of Sri Krishna Chaitanya were a fitting combination that eminently qualified him to present this important classic to the English-speaking world. The entire text, published by the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust of Los Angeles, California, represents a contribution of major importance to the intellectual, cultural, and spiritual life of contemporary man. Many of the verses in this book are followed by extensive and profound commentaries by the translator. However, with deep regret and apology, these commentaries have been omitted from the narration, not because the narrator considers them to be unimportant or unnecessary, but because they go beyond the very scope of this recording. Actually, the commentaries are indispensable for understanding the verses, for they provide illuminating explanations about the persons, places, things, and activities depicted in them from various points of view: political, economic, social, geographical, religious, philosophical, and spiritual. However, the scope of this recording is only to present a dramatic rendering of the verses or stories with a view to arousing in the listener the maximum amount of emotional and devotional feeling towards the Lord and His intimate devotees. To do this with impact, it is necessary for the narrator to recite the verses in an unbroken, continuous fashion as they were originally conceived and penned by Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami. If this purpose can be accomplished, it is hoped that the listener will become so strongly attracted to and interested in the Lord's fascinating pastimes that he or she will want to learn more about them and will thus begin reading the invaluable commentaries in the book. For only by doing this can one begin to deeply understand and appreciate this great biography. And now I, Amala Bhaktadas, offer my humble obeisances to my spiritual master, His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, who is very dear to Lord Krishna, having taken shelter of His lotus feet. O spiritual master, servant of His Divine Grace Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Goswami, you are kindly preaching through your books and devotees the message of Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and delivering the whole world, which is filled with impersonalism and voidism. Bowing repeatedly at your lotus feet, realizing my unfortunate lack of qualifications, and begging incessantly for your mercy, I pray that you may enter my stony heart and manifest your sweet love through my voice, so that all who may hear this epic may be enlivened, inspired, uplifted, and enraptured, all for the glory and pleasure of our beloved Lord, Sri Krishna. Praying for the blessings of all devotees everywhere, I now begin the narration of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Adi Lila, Chapter 1.
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara.
I offer my respectful obeisances unto the spiritual masters, the devotees of the Lord, the Lord's incarnations, his plenary portions, his energies, and the primeval Lord himself, Sri Krishna Chaitanya. I offer my respectful obeisances unto Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda, who are like the sun and moon. They have arisen simultaneously on the horizon of Goda to dissipate the darkness of ignorance and thus wonderfully bestow benediction upon all. What the Upanishads describe as the impersonal Brahman is but the effulgence of his body, and the Lord known as the Supersoul is but his localized plenary portion. He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna himself, full with six opulences. He is the absolute truth, and no other truth is greater than or equal to him. May that Lord, who is known as the son of Srimati Shachi Devi, be transcendentally situated in the innermost chambers of your heart. Resplendent with the radiance of molten gold, he has appeared in the age of Kali by his causeless mercy to bestow what no incarnation ever offered before, the most sublime and radiant spiritual knowledge of the mellow taste of his service. The loving affairs of Sri Radha and Krishna are transcendental manifestations of the Lord's internal pleasure-giving potency. Although Radha and Krishna are one in their identity, they separated themselves eternally. Now these two transcendental identities have again united in the form of Sri Krishna Chaitanya. I bow down to him who has manifested himself with the sentiment and complexion of Srimati Radharani, although he is Krishna himself. Desiring to understand the glory of Radharani's love, the wonderful qualities in him that she alone relishes through her love, and the happiness she feels when she realizes the sweetness of his love, the Supreme Lord Hari, richly endowed with her emotions, appears from the womb of Srimati Shachi Devi as the moon appears from the ocean. May Sri Nityananda Ram be the object of my constant remembrance. Sankarshan Sheshanag and the Vishnus who lie on the Kadan Ocean, Garba Ocean, and Ocean of Milk are his plenary portions and the portions of his plenary portions. I surrender unto the lotus feet of Sri Nityananda Ram, who is known as Sankarshan in the midst of the Chatur Vyuha, consisting of Vasudev, Sankarshan, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. He possesses full opulences and resides in Vaikuntha Loka, far beyond the material creation. I offer my full obeisances unto the feet of Sri Nityananda Ram, whose partial representation, called Karano Dakshai Vishnu, lying on the Karan Ocean, is the original Purush, the master of the illusory energy, and the shelter of all the universes. I offer my full obeisances unto the feet of Sri Nityananda Ram, a partial part of whom is Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. From the navel of Garbhodakshayi Vishnu sprouts the lotus that is the birthplace of Brahma, the engineer of the universe. The stem of that lotus is the resting place of the multitude of planets. I offer my respectful obeisances unto the feet of Sri Nityananda Ram, whose secondary part is the Vishnu lying in the ocean of milk. That Kshirodakshayi Vishnu is the supersoul of all living entities and the maintainer of all the universes. Sheshanag is his further subpart. Lord Advaita Acharya is the incarnation of Mahavishnu, whose main function is to create the cosmic world through the actions of Maya. Because he is none different from Hari, the Supreme Lord, he is called Advait, and because he propagates the cult of devotion, he is called Acharya. He is the Lord and the incarnation of the Lord's devotee. Therefore, I take shelter of him. I offer my obeisances unto the Supreme Lord, Krishna, who is none different from his features as a devotee, devotional incarnation, devotional manifestation, pure devotee, and devotional energy. Glory to the all-merciful Radha and Madan Mohan. I am lame and ill-advised, yet they are my directors, and their lotus feet are everything to me. In a temple of jewels in Vrindavan, underneath a desire tree, Sri Sri Radha Govinda, served by their most confidential associates, sit upon an effulgent throne. I offer my humble obeisances unto them. Sri Srila Gopinath, who originated the transcendental mellow of the Ras dance, stands on the shore of Vamshivat and attracts the attention of the cowherd damsels with the sound of his celebrated flute. May they all confer upon us their benediction. Glory to Sri Chaitanya and Nityananda. Glory to Advaita Chandra. And glory to all the devotees of Sri Gauda, or Lord Chaitanya. These three deities of Vrindavan, Madan Mohan, Govinda, and Gopinath, have absorbed the heart and soul of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas, or followers of Lord Chaitanya. I worship their lotus feet, for they are the lords of my heart. In the beginning of this narration, simply by remembering the spiritual master, the devotees of the Lord, and the personality of Godhead, I have invoked their benedictions. Such remembrance destroys all difficulties and very easily enables one to fulfill his own desires. The invocation involves three processes: defining the objective, offering benedictions, and offering obeisances. The first two verses offer respectful obeisances, generally and specifically to the Lord, who is the object of worship. In the third verse, I indicate the absolute truth, who is the ultimate substance. With such a description, one can visualize the supreme truth. In the fourth verse, I have invoked the benediction of the Lord upon all the world, praying to Lord Chaitanya for his mercy upon all. In that verse, I have also explained the external reason for Lord Chaitanya's incarnation. But in the fifth and sixth verses, I have explained the prime reason for his advent. In these six verses, I have described the truth about Lord Chaitanya, whereas in the next five, I have described the glories of Lord Nityananda. The next two verses describe the truth of Advaita Prabhu, and the following verse describes the Panchatattva, the Lord, his plenary portion, his incarnation, his energies, and his devotees. These 14 verses, therefore, offer auspicious invocations and describe the supreme truth. I offer my obeisances unto all my Vaishnava readers as I begin to explain the intricacies of all these verses. I request all my Vaishnava readers to read and hear with rapt attention this narration of Sri Krishna Chaitanya as inculcated in the revealed scriptures. Lord Krishna enjoys, by manifesting himself as the spiritual masters, the devotees, the diverse energies, the incarnations, and the plenary portions. They are all six in one. I therefore worshipped the lotus feet of these six diversities of the one truth by invoking their benedictions. I offer my respectful obeisances unto the spiritual masters, the devotees of the Lord, the Lord's incarnations, his plenary portions, his energies, and the primeval Lord himself, Sri Krishna Chaitanya. I first offer my respectful obeisances at the lotus feet of my initiating spiritual master and all my instructing spiritual masters. The instructing spiritual masters are Sri Rupa Goswami, Sri Sanatan Goswami, Sri Bhatta Raghunath, Sri Jiva Goswami, Sri Gopal Bhatta Goswami, and Srila Raghunath Das Goswami. These six are my instructing spiritual masters, and therefore I offer millions of respectful obeisances unto their lotus feet. There are innumerable devotees of the Lord, of whom Srivas Thakur is the foremost. I offer my respectful obeisances thousands of times unto their lotus feet. Advaita Acharya is the Lord's partial incarnation, and therefore I offer my obeisances millions of times at his lotus feet. Srila Nityananda Ram is the plenary manifestation of the Lord, and I have been initiated by him. I therefore offer my respectful obeisances unto his lotus feet. I offer my respectful obeisances unto the internal potencies of the Lord, of whom Sri Gadadhar Prabhu is the foremost. Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the personality of Godhead himself, and therefore I offer innumerable prostrations at his lotus feet. Having offered obeisances unto the Lord and all his associates, I shall now try to explain these six diversities in one. Although I know that my spiritual master is a servitor of Sri Chaitanya, I know him also as a plenary manifestation of the Lord. According to the deliberate opinion of all revealed scriptures, the spiritual master is non-different from Krishna. Lord Krishna, in the form of the spiritual master, delivers his devotees. As it is said by Lord Krishna in the Srimad Bhagavatam, "One should know the Acharya as myself and never disrespect him in any way. One should not envy him, thinking him an ordinary man, for he is the representative of all the demigods. One should know the instructing spiritual master to be the personality of Krishna. Lord Krishna manifests himself as the Supersoul and as the greatest devotee of the Lord. As Sri Uddhava said in the Srimad Bhagavatam, "O my Lord, transcendental poets and experts in spiritual science could not fully express their indebtedness to you, even if they were endowed with the prolonged lifetime of Brahma, for you appear in two features, externally as the Acharya, and internally as the Supersoul, to deliver the embodied living being by directing him how to come to you." And Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, "To those who are constantly devoted and worship me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me." The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Svayam Bhagavan, taught Brahma and made himself realized. He said, "Please hear attentively what I shall speak to you, for transcendental knowledge about me is not only scientific, but also full of mysteries. By my causeless mercy, be enlightened in truth about my personality, manifestations, qualities, and pastimes. Prior to the cosmic creation, only I exist, and no phenomena exist, either gross, subtle, or primordial. After creation, only I exist in everything. And after annihilation, only I remain eternally. What appears to be truth without me is certainly my illusory energy, for nothing can exist without me. It is like a reflection of a real light in the shadows, for in the light there are neither shadows nor reflections. As the material elements enter the bodies of all living beings and yet remain outside them all, I exist within all material creations and yet am not within them. A person interested in transcendental knowledge must therefore always directly and indirectly inquire about it to know the all-pervading truth. As it is said in the Krishna Karnamrita, all glories to Chintamani and my initiating spiritual master, Somagiri. All glories to my instructing spiritual master, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who wears peacock feathers in his crown. Under the shade of his lotus feet, which are like desire trees, Jayashri or Radharani enjoys the transcendental mellow of an eternal consort. Since one cannot visually experience the presence of the Supersoul, he appears before us as a liberated devotee. Such a spiritual master is no one other than Krishna himself. As Lord Krishna said to Uddhava in the Srimad Bhagavatam, one should therefore avoid bad company and associate only with devotees. With their realized instructions, such saints can cut the knot connecting one with the activities unfavorable to devotional service. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Kapila said to his mother, the spiritually powerful message of Godhead can be properly discussed only in a society of devotees, and it is greatly pleasing to hear in that association. If one hears from devotees, the way of transcendental experience quickly opens to him, and gradually he attains a taste in knowledge that in due course develops into attraction and devotion. A pure devotee constantly engaged in the loving service of the Lord is identical with the Lord, who is always seated in his heart. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, the Lord says, saints are my heart, and only I am their hearts. They do not know anyone but me, and therefore I do not recognize anyone besides them as mine. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, King Yudhishthir said to Vidura, saints of your caliber are themselves places of pilgrimage. Because of their purity, they are constant companions of the Lord, and therefore they can purify even the places of pilgrimage. Such pure devotees are of two types, personal associates and neophyte devotees. There are three categories of incarnations of Godhead: partial incarnations, qualitative incarnations, and empowered incarnations. The Purushas and Matsya are examples of partial incarnations. Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva are qualitative incarnations. Empowered incarnations are those like the Kumaras, King Prithu, and Mahamuni Vyas, the compiler of the Vedas. The personality of Godhead exhibits himself in two kinds of forms, Prakash and Vilas. When the personality of Godhead expands himself in many forms, all non-different in their features, as Lord Krishna did when he married 16,000 queens and when he performed his Ras dance, such forms of the Lord are called manifested forms. In the Srimad Bhagavatam it is said, It is astounding that Lord Sri Krishna, who is one without a second, expanded himself in 16,000 similar forms to marry 16,000 queens in their respective homes. When Lord Krishna, surrounded by groups of cowherd girls, began the festivities of the Ras dance, the Lord of all mystic powers placed himself between each two girls. When the cowherd girls and Krishna thus joined together, each girl thought that Krishna was dearly embracing her alone. To behold this wonderful pastime of the Lord, the denizens of heaven and their wives, all very eager to see the dance, flew in the sky in their hundreds of airplanes. They showered flowers and beat sweetly on drums. If numerous forms, all equal in their features, are displayed simultaneously, such forms are called Prakash Vigrahas of the Lord. But when the numerous forms are slightly different from one another, they are called Vilas Vigrahas. When the Lord displays numerous forms with different features by his inconceivable potency, such forms are called Vilas Vigrahas. Examples of such Vilas Vigrahas are Baladev, Narayan in Vaikuntha Dham, and Chaturvyuha, Vasudev, Sankarshan, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. The energies or consorts of the Supreme Lord are of three kinds: the Lakshmis in Vaikuntha, the queens in Dvarka, and the gopis in Vrindavan. The gopis are the best of all, for they have the privilege of serving Sri Krishna, the primeval Lord, the son of the king of Vraj. The personal associates of the primeval Lord, Sri Krishna, are his devotees, who are identical with him. He is complete with his entourage of devotees. Now I have worshipped all the various levels of devotees. Worshipping them is the source of all good fortune. In the first verse, I have invoked a general benediction, but in the second, I have prayed to the Lord in a particular form. I offer my respectful obeisances unto Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda, who are like the sun and moon. They have arisen simultaneously on the horizon of Goda to dissipate the darkness of ignorance and thus wonderfully bestow benediction upon all. Sri Krishna and Balaram, the personalities of Godhead, who formerly appeared in Vrindavan and were millions of times more effulgent than the sun and moon, have arisen over the eastern horizon of Goda Desh, or West Bengal, being compassionate for the fallen state of the world. The appearance of Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Prabhu Nityananda has surcharged the world with happiness. As the sun and moon drive away darkness by their appearance and reveal the nature of everything, these two brothers dissipate the darkness of the living being's ignorance and enlighten them with knowledge of the absolute truth. The darkness of ignorance is called Kaitava, the way of cheating, which begins with religiosity, economic development, sense gratification, and liberation. The great scripture, Srimad Bhagavatam, compiled by Mahamuni Vyasadeva from four original verses, describes the most elevated and kind-hearted devotees and completely rejects the cheating ways of materially motivated religiosity. It propounds the highest principle of eternal religion, which can factually mitigate the threefold miseries of a living being and award the highest benediction of full prosperity and knowledge. Those willing to hear the message of this scripture in a submissive attitude of service can at once capture the Supreme Lord in their hearts. Therefore, there is no need for any scripture other than Srimad Bhagavatam. The foremost process of cheating is to desire to achieve liberation by merging in the Supreme. For this causes the permanent disappearance of loving service to Krishna. The prefix pra in the verse from Srimad Bhagavatam indicates that the desire for liberation is completely rejected. All kinds of activities, both auspicious and inauspicious, that are detrimental to the discharge of transcendental loving service to Lord Sri Krishna are actions of the darkness of ignorance. By the grace of Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda, this darkness of ignorance is removed and the truth is brought to light. The absolute truth is Sri Krishna. And loving devotion to Sri Krishna, exhibited in pure love, is achieved through congregational chanting of the holy name, which is the essence of all bliss. The sun and moon dissipate the darkness of the external world, and thus reveal external material objects like pots and plates. But these two brothers, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda, dissipate the darkness of the inner core of the heart, and thus they help one meet the two kinds of Bhagavatas, or persons or things in relationship with the personality of Godhead. One of the Bhagavatas is the great scripture Srimad Bhagavatam, and the other is the pure devotee absorbed in the mellows of loving devotion. Through the actions of these two Bhagavatas, the Lord instills the mellows of transcendental loving service into the heart of a living being. And thus the Lord, in the heart of his devotee, comes under the control of the devotee's love. The first wonder is that both brothers appear simultaneously, and the other is that they illuminate the innermost depths of the heart. These two, the sun and moon, are very kind to the people of the world. Thus, for the good fortune of all, they have appeared on the horizon of Bengal. Let us therefore worship the holy feet of these two lords. Thus, one can be rid of all difficulties on the path of self-realization. I have invoked the benediction of the Lords with these two verses. Now please hear attentively the purport of the third. I purposely avoid extensive description for fear of increasing the bulk of this book. I shall describe the essence as concisely as possible. Essential truth spoken concisely is true eloquence. Simply hearing submissively will free one's heart from all the faults of ignorance, and thus one will achieve deep love for Krishna. This is the path of peace. If one patiently hears about the glories of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sri Nityananda Prabhu, and Sri Advaita Prabhu, and their devotees, devotional activities, names, fame, and the mellows of their transcendental loving exchanges, one will learn the essence of the absolute truth. Therefore, I have described these in Chaitanya Charitamrita with logic and discrimination. Praying at the lotus feet of Sri Rupa and Sri Raghunath, always desiring their mercy, I, Krishna Das, narrate Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, following in their footsteps. This ends chapter 1 of the Adi Leela.
प्रभो नित्यानंदा कियातैत दधाधा सुभाषति गौरभक्तवृन्दा। श्रीकृष्ण चै प्रभो नित्यानन्दैतदधा सुभाषति गौरभक्तवृन्द।
And now chapter 2 of the Adi Lila. I offer my obeisances to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by whose mercy even an ignorant child can swim across the ocean of conclusive truth, which is full of the crocodiles of various theories. O my merciful Lord Chaitanya, may the nectarine Ganges water of your transcendental activities flow on the surface of my desert-like tongue. Beautifying these waters are the lotus flowers of singing, dancing, and loud chanting of Krishna's holy name, which are pleasure abodes of unalloyed devotees. These devotees are compared to swans, ducks, and bees. The river's flowing produces a melodious sound that gladdens their ears. All glories to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Lord Nityananda. All glories to Advaita Chandra. And all glories to the devotees of Lord Gauranga. Let me describe the meaning of the third verse of the first 14. It is an auspicious vibration that describes the absolute truth. What the Upanishads describe as the impersonal Brahman is but the effulgence of his body, and the Lord known as the Supersoul is but his localized plenary portion. He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna himself, full with six opulences. He is the absolute truth, and no other truth is greater than or equal to him. Impersonal Brahman, localized Paramatma, and the personality of Godhead are three subjects, and the glowing effulgence, the partial manifestation, and the original form are their three respective predicates. A predicate always follows its subject. Now I shall explain the meaning of this verse according to the revealed scriptures. Krishna, the original form of the personality of Godhead, is the summum bonum of the all-pervading Vishnu. He is all perfect knowledge and all perfect bliss. He is the supreme transcendence. He whom Srimad Bhagavatam describes as the son of Nanda Maharaj has descended to earth as Lord Chaitanya. In terms of his various manifestations, he is known in three features called the impersonal Brahman, the localized Paramatma, and the original personality of Godhead. Learned transcendentalists who know the absolute truth say that it is non-dual knowledge and is called impersonal Brahman, localized Paramatma, and the personality of Godhead. What the Upanishads call the transcendental, impersonal Brahman is the realm of the glowing effulgence of the same supreme person. As with the naked eye, one cannot know the sun except as a glowing substance. Merely by philosophical speculation, one cannot understand Lord Krishna's transcendental varieties. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who is endowed with great power. The glowing effulgence of his transcendental form is the impersonal Brahman, which is absolute, complete, and unlimited, and which displays the varieties of countless planets with their different opulences in millions and millions of universes. The opulences of the impersonal Brahman spread throughout the millions and millions of universes. That Brahman is but the bodily effulgence of Govinda. Lord Brahma says, "I worship Govinda. He is my Lord. Only by his grace am I empowered to create the universe." Naked saints and sannyasis who undergo severe physical penances, who can raise the semina to the brain, and who are completely equipoised in Brahman, can live in the realm known as Brahmaloka. He who is described in the Yoga Shastras as the indwelling supersoul, or Atma Antaryami, is also a plenary portion of Govinda's personal expansion. As the one sun appears reflected in countless jewels, so Govinda manifests himself as Paramatma in the hearts of all living beings. The personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, said, "What more shall I say to you? I live throughout this cosmic manifestation merely by my single plenary portion." Grandfather Bhishma said, "As the one sun appears differently situated to different seers, so also do you, the unborn, appear differently represented as Paramatma in every living being. But when a seer knows himself to be one of your own servitors, no longer does he maintain such duality. Thus I am now able to comprehend your eternal forms, knowing well the Paramatma to be only your plenary portion." That Govinda personally appears as Chaitanya Goswami. No other Lord is as merciful in delivering the fallen souls. Lord Narayan, who dominates the transcendental world, is full in six opulences. He is the personality of Godhead, the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune. The personality of Godhead is he who is described as the absolute whole in the Vedas, Bhagavatam, Upanishads, and other transcendental literatures. No one is equal to him. Through their service, devotees see that personality of Godhead, just as the denizens of heaven see the personality of the sun. Those who walk the paths of knowledge and yoga worship only him, for it is him they perceive as the impersonal Brahman and localized Paramatma. Thus, one may understand the glories of the Lord through different modes of worship, as the example of the sun illustrates. Narayan and Sri Krishna are the same personality of Godhead, but although they are identical, their bodily features are different. This personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, has two hands and holds a flute, whereas the other, Narayan, has four hands with conch, wheel, mace, and lotus. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Brahma says to the Supreme Lord Krishna, O Lord of Lords, you are the seer of all creation. You are indeed everyone's dearest life. Are you not therefore my father, Narayan? Narayan refers to one whose abode is in the water, born from Nara, Garbhadakshayi Vishnu, and that Narayan is your plenary portion. All your plenary portions are transcendental. They are absolute and are not creations of Maya. After Brahma had offended Krishna by stealing his playmates and cows, he begged the Lord's pardon for his offensive act and prayed for the Lord's mercy. He said, I took birth from the lotus that grew from your navel. Thus you are both my father and my mother, and I am your son. Parents never take seriously the offenses of their children. I therefore beg your pardon and ask for your benediction. The boy, Sri Krishna, said,
O Brahma, your father is Narayan. I am but a cowherd boy. How can you be my son?
Brahma replied, Are you not Narayan? You are certainly Narayan. Please listen as I state the proofs. All the living beings within the material and spiritual worlds are ultimately born of you, for you are the supersoul of them all. As the earth is the original cause and shelter of all pots made of earth, so you are the ultimate cause and shelter of all living beings. The word Nara refers to the aggregate of all the living beings, and the word Ayan refers to the refuge of them all. You are therefore the original Narayan. This is one reason. Please listen as I state the second. The direct lords of the living beings are the Purusha incarnations, but your opulence and power are more exalted than theirs. Therefore, you are the primeval lord, the original father of everyone. They, the Purushas, are protectors of the universes by your power. Since you protect those who are the shelters of all living beings, you, yes, you, are the original Narayan. O my Lord, O Supreme Personality of Godhead, kindly hear my third reason. There are countless universes and fathomless transcendental Vaikunthas. Both in this material world and in the transcendental world, you see all the deeds of all living beings in the past, present, and future. Since you are the witness of all such deeds, you know the essence of everything. All the worlds exist because you, yes, you oversee them. None can live, move, or have their being without your supervision. You oversee the wanderings of all living beings. For this reason also, you are the primeval Lord Narayan. But Krishna said,
Brahma, I cannot understand what you are saying. Lord Narayan is he who sits in the hearts of all living beings and lies down in the waters of the Karana ocean.
Brahma replied, What I have said is true. The same Lord Narayan who lives on the waters and in the hearts of all living beings is but a plenary portion of you. The Karanodakshayi, Garbhadakshayi, and Kshiradakshayi forms of Narayan all create in cooperation with the material energy. In this way, they are attached to Maya. These three Vishnus lying in the water are the supersoul of everything. The supersoul of all the universes is known as the first Purusha.
Garvadakshayi Vishnu is the supersoul of the aggregate of living entities. Ankshuradakshayi Vishnu is the supersoul of each individual living being. Superficially, we see that these Purushas have a relationship with Maya. But above them, in the fourth dimension, is Lord Krishna, who has no contact with the material energy. In the material world, the Lord is designated as Virat, Hiranyagarbha, and Karana. But beyond these three designations, the Lord is ultimately in the fourth dimension. Although these three features of the Lord deal directly with the material energy, none of them are touched by it. They are all beyond illusion. This is the opulence of the Lord. Although situated in the material nature, he is never affected by the modes of nature. Similarly, those who have surrendered to him and fixed their intelligence upon him are not influenced by the modes of nature. You, yes, you are the ultimate shelter of these three plenary portions. Thus, there is not the slightest doubt that you are the primeval Narayan. The source of these three features is the Narayan in the spiritual sky. He is your vilas expansion. Therefore, you are the ultimate Narayan.
Therefore, according to the authority of Brahma, the Narayan, who is the predominating deity in the transcendental world, is but the vilas feature of Krishna. This has now been conclusively proved. The truth indicated in this verse is the essence of Srimad Bhagavatam. This conclusion, though synonymous, applies everywhere. Not knowing that Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan are all features of Krishna, foolish scholars speculate in various ways. Because Narayan has four hands, whereas Krishna looks just like a man, they say that Narayan is the original God, whereas Krishna is but an incarnation. In this way, their arguments appear in various forms. But the poetry of the Bhagavatam expertly refutes them all. In Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said, learned transcendentalists who know the absolute truth say that it is non-dual knowledge and is called impersonal Brahman, localized Paramatma, and the personality of Godhead. My dear brothers, kindly listen to the explanation of this verse and consider its meaning. The one original entity is known in his three different features. Lord Krishna himself is the one undivided absolute truth, the ultimate reality. He manifests himself in three features as Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan. The import of this verse has stopped you from arguing. Now listen to another verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. All these incarnations of Godhead are either plenary portions or parts of the plenary portions of the Purusha avatars. But Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead himself. In every age, he protects the world through his different features. When the world is disturbed by the enemies of Indra. The Bhagavatam describes the symptoms and deeds of the incarnations in general, and counts Sri Krishna among them. This made Suta Goswami greatly apprehensive. Therefore, he distinguished each incarnation by its specific symptoms. All the incarnations of Godhead are plenary portions or parts of the plenary portions of the Purusha avatars. But the primeval Lord is Sri Krishna. He is the supreme personality of Godhead, the fountainhead of all incarnations. An opponent may say, "This is your interpretation." But actually, the Supreme Lord is Narayan, who is in the transcendental realm. He incarnates as Lord Krishna. This is the meaning of the verse as I see it. There is no need for further consideration. Now, to such a misguided interpreter, we may reply, "Why should you suggest such fallacious logic? An interpretation is never accepted as evidence if it opposes the principles of Scripture. One should not state a predicate before its subject, for it cannot thus stand without proper support. If I do not state a subject, I do not state a predicate. First I speak the former, and then I speak the latter. The predicate of a sentence is what is unknown to the reader, whereas the subject is what is known to him. For example, we may say, this Vipra or Brahman is a greatly learned man. In this sentence, the Vipra is the subject, and the predicate is his erudition. The man's being a Vipra is known, but his erudition is unknown. Therefore, the person is identified first, and his erudition later. In the same way, all these incarnations were known, but whose incarnations they are was unknown. First, the word ete, meaning these, establishes the subject or incarnations. Then, plenary portions of the Purusha avatars follows as the predicate. In the same way, when Krishna was first counted among the incarnations, specific knowledge about him was still unknown. Therefore, first the word Krishna appears as the subject, followed by the predicate, describing him as the original personality of Godhead. This establishes that Sri Krishna is the original personality of Godhead. The original personality of Godhead is therefore necessarily Krishna. Had Krishna been the plenary portion and Narayan the primeval Lord, the statement of Sutta Goswami would have been reversed. Thus he would have said, Narayan, the source of all incarnations, is the original personality of Godhead. He has appeared as Sri Krishna. Mistakes, illusions, cheating, and defective perception do not occur in the sayings of the authoritative sages. You say something contradictory and become angry when this is pointed out. Your explanation has the defect of a misplaced object. This is an unconsidered adjustment. Only the personality of Godhead, the source of all other divinities, is eligible to be designated Svayam Bhagavan, or the primeval Lord. When from one candle many others are lit, I consider that one the original. Krishna, in the same way, is the cause of all causes and all incarnations. Please hear another verse to defeat all misinterpretations. Here in Srimad Bhagavatam, 10 subjects are described. The creation of the ingredients of the cosmos. 2. The creations of Brahma. 3. The maintenance of the creation. 4. Special favor given to the faithful. 5. Impetuses for activity. 6.
prescribed duties for law-abiding men, 7, a description of the incarnations of the Lord, 8, the winding up of the creation, 9, liberation from gross and subtle material existence, and 10, the ultimate shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The 10th item is the shelter of all the others. To distinguish this ultimate shelter from the other 9 subjects, the Mahajans have described these 9 directly or indirectly through prayers or direct explanations. To know distinctly the ultimate shelter of everything that be, I have described the other 9 categories. The cause for the appearance of these 9 is rightly called their shelter. The Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, is the shelter and abode of everything. All the universes rest in His body. The 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam reveals the 10th object, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the shelter of all surrendered souls. He is known as Sri Krishna, and He is the ultimate source of all the universes. Let me offer my obeisances unto Him. One who knows the real feature of Sri Krishna and His 3 different energies cannot remain ignorant about Him. The Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, enjoys Himself in 6 primary expansions. His 2 manifestations are Prabhav and Vaibhav. His incarnations are of 2 kinds, namely partial and empowered. He appears in 2 ages, childhood and boyhood. The Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, who is eternally an adolescent, is the primeval Lord, the source of all incarnations. He expands Himself in these 6 categories of forms to establish His supremacy throughout the universe. In these 6 kinds of forms, there are innumerable varieties. Although they are many, they are all one. There is no difference between them. The Chit Shakti, which is also called Svarup Shakti or Antaranga Shakti, displays many varied manifestations. It sustains the kingdom of God and its paraphernalia. The external energy, called Maya Shakti, is the cause of innumerable universes with varied material potencies. The marginal potency, which is between these 2, consists of the numberless living beings. These are the 3 principal energies which have unlimited categories and subdivisions. These are the principal manifestations and expansions of the Personality of Godhead and His 3 energies. They are all emanations from Sri Krishna, the Transcendence. They have their existence in Him. Although the 3 Purushas are the shelter of all the universes, Lord Krishna is the original source of the Purushas. Thus, the Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, is the original primeval Lord, the source of all other expansions. All the revealed scriptures accept Sri Krishna as the Supreme Lord. In the Brahma Samhita it is said, Krishna, who is known as Govinda, is the Supreme Controller. He has an eternal, blissful, spiritual body. He is the origin of all. He has no other origin, for He is the prime cause of all causes. You know all the conclusions of the scriptures very well. You create these logical arguments just to agitate me. The same Lord Krishna, the fountainhead of all incarnations, is known as the son of the king of Vraj. He has descended personally
as Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, Lord Chaitanya is the supreme absolute truth. To call him Kshiradakshayi Vishnu does not add to his glory. But such words from the lips of a sincere devotee cannot be false. All possibilities abide in him, for he is the primeval Lord. All other incarnations are potentially situated in the body of the primeval Lord. Thus, according to one's opinion, one may address him as any one of the incarnations. Some say that Sri Krishna is directly Naranarayan. Others say that he is directly Vaman. Some say that Krishna is the incarnation of Kshiradakshayi Vishnu. None of these statements is impossible. Each is as correct as the others. Some call him Hari, or the Narayan of the transcendental world. Everything is possible in Krishna, for he is the primeval Lord. I offer my obeisances unto the feet of all who hear or read this discourse. Kindly hear with attention the conclusion of all these statements. A sincere student should not neglect the discussion of such conclusions, considering them controversial, for such discussions strengthen the mind. Thus one's mind becomes attached to Sri Krishna. By such conclusive studies, I know the glories of Lord Chaitanya. Only by knowing these glories can one become strong and fixed in attachment to him. Just to enunciate the glories of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I have tried to describe the glories of Sri Krishna in detail. The conclusion is that Lord Chaitanya is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, the son of the King of Vraj. Praying at the lotus feet of Sri Rupa and Sri Raghunath, always desiring their mercy, I, Krishna Das, narrate Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, following in their footsteps. This ends Chapter 2 of the Adi Leela.
Chaitanya Prabho Nityananda Chaita Vadadhan Subhashati Gaurabhata Puna
And now Chapter 3 of the Adi Leela. I offer my respectful obeisances to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. By the potency of the shelter of his lotus feet, even a fool can collect the valuable jewels of conclusive truth from the minds of the revealed scriptures. All glories to Lord Chaitanya. All glories to Lord Nityananda. All glories to Advaita Chandra. And all glories to all the devotees of Lord Chaitanya. I have given the purport of the third verse. Now, O devotees, please listen to the meaning of the fourth with full attention. Srila Rupa Goswami says in his Vidagdha Madhava, May that Lord, who is known as the son of Srimati Shachi Devi, be transcendentally situated in the innermost core of your heart. resplendent with the radiance of molten gold, he has descended in the age of Kali by his causeless mercy to bestow what no incarnation has ever offered before, the most elevated mellow of devotional service, the mellow of conjugal love. Lord Krishna, the son of the king of Vraj, is the Supreme Lord. He eternally enjoys transcendental pastimes in his eternal abode, Goloka, which includes Vrajadham. Once in a day of Brahma, he descends to this world to manifest his transcendental pastimes. We know that there are four ages or yugas, namely Satya, Treta, Dvapara, and Kali. These four together comprise one Divya Yug. 71 Divya Yugs constitute one Manvantara. There are 14 Manvantaras in one day of Brahma. The present Manu, who is the seventh, is called Vivasvata, or the son of Vivasvan. 27 Divya Yugas, or 27 times 4,320,000 solar years of his age, have now passed. At the end of the Dvapara Yug, of the 28th Divya Yug, Lord Krishna appears on earth with the full paraphernalia of his eternal Vrajadham. Servitude, friendship, parental affection, and conjugal love are the four transcendental mellows. By the devotees who cherish these four mellows, Lord Krishna is subdued. Absorbed in such transcendental love, Lord Sri Krishna enjoys in Vraj with his devoted servants, friends, parents, and conjugal lovers. Lord Krishna enjoys his transcendental pastimes as long as he wishes, and then he disappears. After disappearing, however, he thinks thus: for a long time I have not bestowed unalloyed loving service to me upon the inhabitants of the world. Without such loving attachment, the existence of the material world is useless. Everywhere in the world people worship me according to the scriptural injunctions. But simply by following such regulative principles, one cannot attain the loving sentiments of the devotees in Vrajabhumi. Knowing my opulences, the whole world looks upon me with awe and veneration. But devotion, made feeble by such reverence, does not attract me. By performing such regulated devotional service in awe and veneration, one may go to Vaikuntha and attain the four kinds of liberation. These liberations are Sarshti, achieving opulences equal to those of the Lord; Sarupya, having a form the same as the Lord's; Samipya, living as a personal associate of the Lord; and Salokya, living on a Vaikuntha planet. Devotees never accept Sayuja, however, since that is oneness with Brahman. I shall personally inaugurate the religion of the age, Nam Sankirtan, the congregational chanting of the holy name. I shall make the world dance in ecstasy, realizing the four mellows of loving devotional service. I shall accept the role of a devotee, and I shall teach devotional service by practicing it myself. Unless one practices devotional service himself, he cannot teach it to others. This conclusion is indeed confirmed throughout the Gita and Bhagavatam. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharat, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. To deliver the pious
and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to reestablish the principles of religion, I myself appear, millennium after millennium. If I did not show the proper principles of religion, all these worlds would fall into ruin. I would be a cause of unwanted population and would spoil all these living beings. Whatever actions a great man performs, common men follow. And whatever standards he sets by exemplary acts, all the world pursues. My plenary portions can establish the principles of religion for each age. No one but me, however, can bestow the kind of loving service performed by the residents of Vraj. There may be many auspicious incarnations of the personality of Godhead, but who other than Lord Krishna can bestow love of God upon the surrendered souls? Therefore, in the company of my devotees, I shall appear on earth and perform various colorful pastimes. Thinking thus, the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna himself, descended at Nadia early in the age of Kali. Thus, the lion-like Lord Chaitanya has appeared in Navadvip. He has the shoulders of a lion, the powers of a lion, and the loud voice of a lion. May that lion be seated in the core of the heart of every living being. Thus, with his resounding roar, may he drive away one's elephantine vices. In his early pastimes, he is known as Vishvambara, because he floods the world with the nectar of devotion, and thus saves the living beings. The verbal root, Dubrin, which is the root of the word Vishvambara, indicates nourishing and maintaining. He, Lord Chaitanya, nourishes and maintains the three worlds by distributing love of God. In his later pastimes, he is known as Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya. He blesses the whole world by teaching about the name and fame of Lord Sri Krishna. Knowing him, Lord Chaitanya, to be the incarnation for the Kali Yuga, Garga Muni, during the naming ceremony of Krishna, predicted his appearance. He said, "This boy, Krishna, has three other colors, white, red, and yellow, as he appears in different ages. Now he has appeared in a transcendental blackish color. White, red, and yellow. These are the three bodily lusters that the Lord, the husband of the goddess of fortune, assumes in the ages of Satya, Treta, and Kali, respectively. Now in the Dwapara Yuga, the Lord has descended in a blackish hue. This is the essence of the statements in the Puranas and other Vedic literatures with reference to the context. In the Dwapara Yuga, the personality of Godhead appears in a blackish hue. He is dressed in yellow. He holds his own weapons, and he is decorated with the Kastuba jewel and marks of Sri Vatsa. This is how his symptoms are described. The religious practice for the age of Kali is to broadcast the glories of the holy name. Only for this purpose has the Lord, in a yellow color, descended as Lord Chaitanya. The luster of his expansive body resembles molten gold. The deep sounds of his voice conquers the thundering of newly assembled clouds. One who measures 4 cubits in height and in breadth by his own hand is celebrated as a great personality. Such a person is called Niyagroda Parimandala. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who personifies all good qualities, has the body of a Niyagroda Parimandala.
His arms are long enough to reach his knees. His eyes are just like lotus flowers. His nose is like a sesame flower. And his face is as beautiful as the moon. He is peaceful, self-controlled, and fully devoted to the transcendental service of Lord Sri Krishna. He is affectionate toward his devotees. He is gentle, and he is equally disposed toward all living beings. He is decorated with sandalwood bangles and armlets, and anointed with the pulp of sandalwood. He especially wears these decorations to dance in Sri Krishna's Sankirtan. Recording all these qualities of Lord Chaitanya, the sage Vaishampayan included his name in the Vishnu Sahasranam, or the 1,000 Names of Vishnu. The pastimes of Lord Chaitanya have two divisions, the early pastimes, or Adilila, and later pastimes, or Shesha Lila. He has four names in each of these two Lilas. In his early pastimes, he appears as a householder with a golden complexion. His limbs are beautiful, and his body, smeared with the pulp of sandalwood, seems like molten gold. In his later pastimes, he accepts the sannyas order, and he is equipoised and peaceful. He is the highest abode of peace and devotion, for he silences the impersonalist non-devotees. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is repeatedly and clearly said that the essence of religion in the age of Kali is the chanting of the holy name of Krishna. The saint Karabhajan said, "O king, in this way people in Dvapara Yug worship the Lord of the universe. In Kali Yug, they also worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead by the regulations of the revealed scriptures. Kindly now hear of that from me." In the age of Kali, intelligent persons perform congregational chanting to worship the incarnation of Godhead, who constantly sings the name of Krishna. Although his complexion is not blackish, he is Krishna himself. He is accompanied by his associates, servants, weapons, and confidential companions. My dear brothers, please hear all these glories of Lord Chaitanya. This verse clearly summarizes his activities and characteristics. The two syllables, Krishna, are always in his mouth, or he constantly describes Krishna with great pleasure. These are two meanings of the word Krishna Varna. Indeed, nothing else but Krishna issues from his mouth. If someone tries to describe him as being of blackish complexion, the next adjective immediately restricts him. His complexion is certainly not blackish. Indeed, his not being blackish indicates that his complexion is yellow. Srila Rupa Goswami, in his Stava Mala, says, "By performing the sacrifice of congregational chanting of the holy name, learned scholars in the age of Kali worship Lord Krishna, who is now non-blackish because of the great upsurge of the feelings of Srimati Radharani. He is the only worshipable deity for the Paramahansas, who have attained the highest stage of the fourth order or sannyas. May that Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Chaitanya, show us great causeless mercy." One can vividly see his glowing complexion of molten gold, which dispels the darkness of ignorance. The sinful life of the living beings results from ignorance. To destroy that ignorance, he has brought various weapons, such as his plenary associates, his devotees, and the holy name. The greatest ignorance consists of activities, whether religious or irreligious, that are opposed
to devotional service. They are to be known as sins. Raising his arms, chanting the holy name, and looking upon all with deep love, he drives away all sins and floods everyone with love of Godhead. May the Supreme Personality of Godhead, in the form of Lord Sri Chaitanya, bestow his causeless mercy upon us. His smiling glance at once drives away all the bereavements of the world, and his very words enliven the auspicious creepers of devotion by expanding their leaves. Taking shelter of his lotus feet invokes transcendental love of God at once. Anyone who looks upon his beautiful body or beautiful face becomes freed from all sins and obtains the wealth of love of Godhead. In other incarnations, the Lord descended with armies and weapons, but in this incarnation, his soldiers are his plenary parts and associates. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is always the most worshipable deity of the demigods, including Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma, who came in the garb of ordinary men, bearing love for him. He instructs his own pure devotional service to his own devotees. Will he again be the object of my vision? His plenary parts and associates perform the work of weapons as their own specific duties. Please hear from me another meaning of the word Anga. According to the evidence of the revealed scriptures, a bodily limb or Anga is also called a part or Amsa. And a part of a limb is called a partial part or Upanga. O Lord of Lords, you are the seer of all creation. You are indeed everyone's dearest life. Are you not therefore my father Narayan? Narayan refers to one whose abode is in the water, born from Nara or Garbhadakshayi Vishnu. And that Narayan is your plenary portion. All your plenary portions are transcendental. They are absolute and are not creations of Maya. The manifestation of the Narayan who predominates in everyone's heart, as well as the Narayan who lives in the waters, Karana, Garbha, and Kshira, is your plenary portion. You are therefore the original Narayan. The word Anga indeed refers to plenary portions. Such manifestations should never be considered products of material nature, for they are all transcendental, full of knowledge, and full of bliss. Sri Advaita Prabhu and Sri Nityananda Prabhu are both plenary portions of Lord Chaitanya. Thus they are the limbs or Angas of his body. The parts of these two limbs are called the Upangas. Thus the Lord is equipped with sharp weapons in the forms of his parts and plenary portions. All these weapons are competent enough to crush the faithless atheists. Sri Nityananda Gosani is directly Haladara, or Lord Balaram, and Advaita Acharya is the personality of Godhead himself. These two captains, with their soldiers, such as Srivas Thakur, travel everywhere, chanting the holy name of the Lord. Lord Nityananda's very features indicate that he is the subduer of the unbelievers. All sins and unbelievers flee from the loud shouts of Advaita Acharya. Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya is the initiator of the Sankirtan or congregational chanting of the holy name of the Lord. One who worships him through Sankirtan is fortunate indeed. Such a person is truly intelligent, whereas others who have but a poor fund of knowledge must endure a cycle of repeated birth and death.
Of all sacrificial performances, the chanting of the holy name is the most sublime. One who says that 10 million Ajvamedha sacrifices are equal to the chanting of the holy name of Lord Krishna is undoubtedly an atheist. He is sure to be punished by Yamaraj, the Lord of Death. In the auspicious introduction of Bhagavat Sandarbha, Srila Jiva Goswami has given the following verse as an explanation. I take shelter of Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is outwardly of a fair complexion, but is inwardly Krishna himself. In this age of Kali, he displays his expansions, or his angas and upangas, by performing congregational chanting of the holy name of the Lord. In the Upapuranas, we hear Sri Krishna showing his mercy to Vyasadeva by speaking to him as follows. O learned Brahman, sometimes I accept the renounced order of life to induce the fallen people of the age of Kali to accept devotional service to the Lord. Srimad Bhagavatam, Mahabharata, the Puranas, and other Vedic literatures all give evidence to prove that Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the incarnation of Krishna. One can also directly see Lord Chaitanya's manifest influence in his uncommon deeds and uncommon Krishna conscious realization. But faithless unbelievers do not see what is clearly evident, just as owls do not see the rays of the sun. O my Lord, those influenced by demoniac principles cannot realize you, although you are clearly the supreme by dint of your exalted activities, forms, character, and uncommon power, which are confirmed by all the revealed scriptures in the quality of goodness, and the celebrated transcendentalists in the divine nature. Lord Sri Krishna tries to hide himself in various ways, but nevertheless his pure devotees know him as he is. O my Lord, everything within material nature is limited by time, space, and thought. Your characteristics, however, being unequaled and unsurpassed, are always transcendental to such limitations. You sometimes cover such characteristics by your own energy. Nevertheless, your unalloyed devotees are always able to see you under all circumstances. Those whose nature is demoniac cannot know Krishna at any time, but he cannot hide himself from his pure devotees. There are two classes of men in the created world. One consists of the demoniac and the other of the godly. The devotees of Lord Vishnu are the godly, whereas those who are just the opposite are called demons. Advaitacharya Goswami is an incarnation of the Lord as a devotee. His loud calling was the cause for Krishna's incarnation. Whenever Sri Krishna desires to manifest his incarnation on earth, first he creates the incarnations of his respectable predecessors. Thus, respectable personalities such as his father, mother, and spiritual master all take birth on earth first. Madhavendra Puri, Ishvara Puri, Srimati Shachimata, and Srila Jagannath Mishra all appeared with Sri Advaitacharya. Advaitacharya having appeared, he found the world devoid of devotional service to Sri Krishna because people were engrossed in material affairs. Everyone was engaged in material enjoyment, whether sinfully or virtuously.
no one was interested in the transcendental service of the Lord, which can give total relief from the repetition of birth and death. Seeing the activities of the world, the Acharya felt compassion and began to ponder how he could act for the people's benefit. He thought,
if Sri Krishna were to appear as an incarnation, he himself could preach devotion by his personal example. In this age of Kali, there is no religion other than the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. But how in this age will the Lord appear as an incarnation? I shall worship Krishna in a purified state of mind. I shall constantly petition him in humbleness. My name, Advaita, will be fitting if I am able to induce Krishna to inaugurate the movement of the chanting of the holy name.
While he was thinking about how to propitiate Krishna by worship, the following verse came to his mind.
Sri Krishna, who is very affectionate toward his devotees, sells himself to a devotee who offers merely a tulsi leaf and a palm full of water.
Advaita Acharya considered the meaning of the verse in this way. Not finding any way to repay the debt he owes to one who offers him a tulsi leaf and water, Lord Krishna thinks, there is no wealth in my possession that is equal to a tulsi leaf and water. Thus the Lord liquidates the debt by offering his own self to the devotee. Considering this, the Acharya began worshipping the Lord. Thinking of the lotus feet of Sri Krishna, he constantly offered tulsi buds in the water from the Ganges. He appealed to Sri Krishna with loud calls and thus made it possible for Krishna to appear. Therefore, the principal reason for Sri Chaitanya's descent is this appeal by Advaitacharya. The Lord, the protector of religion, appears by the desire of his devotee. In the Srimad Bhagavatam it is said, O my Lord, you always dwell in the vision and hearing of your pure devotees. You also live in their lotus-like hearts, which are purified by devotional service. O my Lord, who are glorified by exalted prayers, you show special favor to your devotees by manifesting yourself in the eternal forms in which they welcome you. The essence of the meaning of this verse is that Lord Krishna appears in all his innumerable eternal forms because of the desires of his pure devotees. Thus I have surely determined the meaning of the fourth verse. Lord Gauranga, or Lord Chaitanya, appeared as an incarnation to preach unalloyed love of God. Praying at the lotus feet of Sri Rupa and Sri Raghunath, always desiring their mercy, I, Krishna Das, narrate Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, following in their footsteps. This ends Chapter 3 of the